Welcome, everybody. We're so glad that you can be with us today. This morning, we want to remind everyone that we're still online and we're in person during the month of August at 10:30 on Sunday morning. So we certainly hope that you're having a great time and day wherever you're going to be worshiping with us. We also want to take a moment to recognize some very special rising first graders today. At First Baptist, it is a tradition that we recognize our young students who have just finished kindergarten. What a strange kindergarten year they had. And they're going to be starting first grade. And we give them a Bible of their own during that time. So this year, we have four amazing young students who are going to be entering first grade again, during a very unusual time, and we wish them all the best, and we wish all the students who are starting school the best this year, and the teachers and the parents. But today, we're going to take just a moment to think about four students. We have got Rosie Eccles, Liliana Keggy, Henry Owen, and Ben Roller. Congratulations to our rising first graders. We hope that the Bible is something that you use often with your family and later on all by yourself.
Sweetest of loves.
you know what I've got right here? It's my 2020 Mr. Rogers calendar. And I love calendars. I'm one of those people who likes to look at the days and the weeks and the months and see what's happening. Calendars help us record time, don't they? Calendars help us even put down very important dates or special occasions. And it's kind of nice to remember special occasions, isn't it? Time is one of those things that we don't change, we can't change it, but we like to remember times that are especially good and celebrate things that happen that are really important, don't we? And calendars help us do that. And today, I want to talk about somebody who has been here at First Baptist for 5 years. Now let's see if you can guess who this person is. Some of you know because you helped to make some cards for this special person, and we're going to give him these to help his day be even more special. This person, well, he does a lot of things. He helps people if they need help. He helps people when they're feeling sad if something has happened in their life to make them hopefully be able to feel better and get through things. He helps them celebrate when there's fun things like weddings and anniversaries. He helps people by praying with them. He prays for you. He helps people by teaching them. He teaches me things all the time. He helps us by sharing God's love. And he shares his love too. He loves all of us. He loves you. He does. He really does. Do you know who this is? Have you guessed? Well, if you guessed Pastor Barrett, you're right. He has been here at First Baptist Church for 5 years. And he's done so many things with us and for us and for other people all around Waynesboro. And we're so glad that he's here at First Baptist. And we're so thankful that he does love us and share God's love with us. We're so thankful that he shares his wisdom, that he encourages us to learn new things and think about things in different ways. We're so thankful that he's here to help us through tough times like right now, and in times where we haven't been so worried. He's with us all the time, thinking about you, thinking about me, thinking about our church. So thank you, Pastor Barrett, for all you do. These 5 years, you have done so many things for us. And today, we hope you enjoy some of the things that we're doing for you.
As the chairman of the Personnel Committee, it is my privilege to speak not just for the committee, but for you, the larger church community, as we recognize 5 wonderful years of Barrett's ministry with us. His sermons have inspired us and challenged us to look inward, outward, and upward. His pastoral care has been the source of comfort for us, and his model of ministry to the church and to the larger Waynesboro community has been an example and has also been the source of justifiable pride. To him, to Barrett, we would say we are grateful to you for sharing your ministry skills and gifts with us at First Baptist, and we are grateful to God for calling you here to labor among us. It is with a deep source of joy that I present to you, Barrett, this token of our love and appreciation in recognition for the 5 wonderful years that we've been doing, loving, and walking together. And may I also say that we anticipate many more years of the same. So to Barrett, God bless you, and we love you, and we are fortunate to have you as our pastor.
Our scripture lesson comes from the book of Job, chapter 28, verses 20 through 28. Where then does wisdom come from, and where is the place of understanding? It is hidden from the eyes of all living and concealed from the birds of the air. Abandoned in death, say, we have heard a rumor of it with our ears. God understands the way to it and knows its place. For he looks to the ends of the earth and sees everything under the heavens. When he gave to the wind its weight and apportioned out of the waters by measure, when he made a decree for the rain and a way for the thunderbolt, then he saw it and declared it. He established it and searched it out. And he said to humankind, truly, the fear of the Lord, that is wisdom. And to depart from evil is understanding.
Thank you.
Grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, the courage to change the things that I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. Theologian Reinhold Niebuhr penned this prayer decades ago. We now know it as the Serenity Prayer. I mean, I've thought a lot about this prayer lately, especially the phrase, accepting the things I cannot change. To me, this summarizes almost entirely the book of Job. Job can't change the cosmic battle between God and Satan. He can't bring back his herds of cattle or his children or even his wife. He can't reclaim that which has been taken from him unto death. He's left alone to figure out how to accept the things he cannot change. And how he does it is a masterclass in pursuing wisdom. The first five chapters of Job are some of the most grueling and heartaching in all of the Bible. I mean, it just gets worse and worse and worse for him. I mean, everything is stripped from Job. And then for like the next 20 chapters, the spotlight centers on him in center stage, and he is broken, lost, confounded, and we see someone searching every corner of his soul for something serene. What makes Job stand out to me as a book in the Bible is that it's so real and raw. It doesn't connect with the larger movements of the Bible. It doesn't further the story of creation or of Israel. It doesn't go into the history of wars or battles, and it doesn't even have prophetic oracles. It's unlike anything else in the Bible. In Job, suffering is personal, not communal. In other parts of the Bible, we suffer alongside Israel as they're held captive by the Egyptians and the Assyrians and the Babylonians and the Persians. I mean, the Bible, both the Old and the New Testaments, is meant mostly about the collective suffering of humankind and its counterpart, the collective healing of humankind. But not in Job. Job is about the inner anguish of the one, of the individual. It's about the depth and truth of the anguish that we all carry in here, in our soul. We don't have time to go over all the movements of the book or even look into all the finer points of it. But if you've never read Job, now it's long and labor intensive, but you need to read it, especially now when there's so much that seems out of our control in this world. I think what we're feeling in life right now, the anguish of having to admit the things we cannot change, like coronavirus, or jobs, or economy, school, church, sports, social gatherings, the family time that we're experiencing. I think Job speaks to how we can navigate these dark feelings. So my first grade teacher was Miss Jama Wright. I have so many memories from that first grade year. Learning to spell multiple syllable words, the spelling tests. I mean, I remember the color and smell of the room, the way that Miss Wright conducted her class. I remember an art project where I won second place because I drew a map of a zoo, and I was getting to put my expertise on when and where animals go in the layout of the zoo. I remember the first place of that art project went to Tommy McClure. He, at even seven, was a legit artist. I remember he drew a pirate ship that looked like it could burst off the page and sail away. I remember taking a spelling test and having to spell the word R, A-R-E. I remember getting it right because I studied the night before, and I remember feeling anxious, sitting in my bed, thinking and telling myself this could be tricky for me on the test. I don't want to get confused over the silent E. Now, Mrs. Wright's class made a lifelong impression on me. I mean, your first grade year is pivotal. But now, thanks to COVID-19, that's been taken away from my son. His first grade memory will be sitting at home on a computer, and there's nothing we can do to change it. We have to accept the things we cannot change, even though it's hard. And this is the path to wisdom. Now, I don't blame the school system. They're doing the best they can with the information in front of them, and they are trying to manage the changing complexities of the landscape. And they're also making decisions for the collective, for thousands of families. But even though it's the right decision for our schools to go virtual right now, it still creates anguish for the one. And that's where Job comes in for me. Job is wrestling with his inner anguish and the loss of everything he holds dear. So he draws wisdom from some of his closest friends and from God. There's something we need to see in this. Job values the wisdom of his closest friends, and he seeks for wisdom from God through prayer. These two avenues are something we must also take. Even though we're socially distancing, there are ways to stay connected to friends and family, and we need to let those who love us speak into our anguish. We need to share our feelings with them and draw from their wisdom. But that can't be all we do. We also need to take that anguish to God in prayer, because wisdom is not always found in friendships alone. I mean, as a matter of fact, Job's friends, they don't actually turn out to be all that helpful, but at least they show up in the midst of his pain. And their presence helps Job work through his anguish and eventually land at this prayer in chapter 28. Our text today is known as the Wisdom Prayer, and it holds the answer for how we can best learn to accept the things we cannot change. Let's read this together, starting in verse 20. Where then does wisdom come from? And where is the place of understanding? It is hidden from the eyes of all living and concealed from the birds of the air. Wisdom is hidden. It's not something we can see. It's beyond us. Look at verse 22. Abandon and death say, we have heard a rumor of it with our ears. I like this. Job's not afraid to personify something. Like here, not even death itself can touch the wisdom of the earth. I like this because it reminds me, not so much literally, but more poetically and mythically, that there's more happening in our world than what our eyes can see. I mean, look at verses 23 and 24. God understands the way to it, and he knows its place. For he looks to the ends of the earth and sees everything under the heavens. God is the one who knows it all, who holds it all, who sees it all, and uses wisdom to create it all. In 25 and 27, when he gave to the wind its weight and apportioned out of the waters by measure, when he made a decree for the rain and a way for the thunderbolt, then he saw it and declared it. He established it and searched it out. For Job, wisdom is personified as both ancient and cosmic. It was around alongside God before creation, and God uses wisdom as a plumb line for creation itself. And Job is speaking philosophically here, but he's using flesh tones to do it. I mean, Job 28 really is quite a piece of literature, and it's worthy of all of our contemplation. So to recap, we need wisdom to accept the things we cannot change. But this kind of wisdom isn't accessible to us alone. It's cosmic in size, it's ancient in age, and only God can see it. But we can access it, though. And verse 28 tells us how. And he said to the human race, the fear of the Lord, that is wisdom. And to shun evil is understanding. There are lots of ways to interpret this verse. Perhaps journaling about it would help you tap into the deep reservoir of its truth. But Job 28 tells us we can tap into something cosmic in nature of God's abiding wisdom when we fear the Lord and shun evil. Now, Skip talked about fearing the Lord last week. You can't read wisdom literature without wrestling with this notion, and I think of it like this. To fear God is to live with great reverence that there is a God who holds all things, and we aren't it, but we're tethered to it. There's more happening in this life than we can control or change. we're powerless to its unfolding. To free ourselves from thinking that we can control everything, we need to realize we're tethered to God, and God is our path towards wisdom. You need to wrestle with this thought. On Thursday of this last week, I spent the morning filming and editing Janice's Storytime video, but I couldn't get it all done before lunch. Noelle had a patient visit that afternoon, so I went home for lunch and I brought the kids back to my office for the afternoon. If you don't know, my kids are 6 and 4. I have some games and toys that I keep in my office for them to play with, and they were playing nicely. I was at my desk editing Janice on my computer, and when you edit videos, I have to match up the audio recording and the video. It takes a bit of repetition to do this, so you end up hearing the same line over and over again to try to match it up. And I just so happened to be at the space where Janice was saying, "Wear a mask at school, wearing a mask at school." This is what her story time was about this week. There's a point to this story, I'm getting to it. At that time, I hear Georgia lament to her brother, "I have to wear a mask at school." And Henry asked her, "Is it hard for you to keep it on?" And Georgia responded sheepishly, "Yeah." Henry comforted his sister by saying, "Georgia, you can do it. We wear them to keep us safe. And look, at least you get to go to school. I'd wear a mask if it meant being in school." Listen, our kids, all of our kids, whether they say it or not, have deep feelings about what's happening in our world. Now, I come from a long line of thinkers that believe every child is marked with the divine. We all bear Christ's light, and we are never as close to that light than when we are kids. It's like time and ego kind of pull us away from staying tethered to that light. And most of our faith journey seems like what we're doing is trying to find ways to return or re-tether to that light. But kids, they have access to deep wisdom because they're still tethered to the divine. That moment in my office was holy ground. My son was reminding his little sister that she has the power within her to accept the things she cannot change, and this will help heal her inner anguish. And they know this to be true because they're still tethered to God. Job had to relearn this. And we see that he does, and he gets there in chapter 28. If we want to tap into the divine wisdom, we too must learn and relearn how to tether ourselves to God. And we do this so when the inner anguish comes, which it's going to, we don't have to pretend or avoid or gloss over or even deny the pain and the anguish. But rather we can face it head on because we have an anchor to hold when we're in it. God is our anchor in the midst of our storm. Deep wisdom flows to us when we know in the midst of our inner anguish that we're tethered to God.